Hey everyone, you're hanging here in the Kramer Corner with us Friday evening. It's a weekend. We're about ready to pump it up, having some fun with our third program introduced here on the channel of EVH and Gear TV. It's been a fun ride. We started off with EVH and Gear TV a couple years ago, EVH Gear Discussion, TV, all that kind of stuff. We brought in the Helix Hour, and now we're bringing in something really cool as well, too, called Kramer Korner. And what Kramer Korner is all about is kind of sharing the love and the legacy of Kramer Guitars, which we're, you know, talking in the chat here just a moment ago. Respected worldwide and by multiple generations. And I figured, you know, when you launch a new show, you got to come out with the best guest you can possibly have for the very first episode. And I'm joined by my good friend and connected as much as you can be connected with the brand, Aljon Go from Kramer and Gibson Brands. Aljon, how are you? And tell us a little bit about yourself. Oh, we lost your audio.
I am good. I had to unmute my microphone.
No problem.
I didn't want to commit any faux pas. But anyway, so thanks for having me, Eric.
Oh, it's a pleasure.
Especially on this very brand new program you're launching, Kramer Korner. And I am a product specialist for the Gibson Brands Company and representing Kramer tonight. And I'm so excited to be here. I've been with the company for 13 years and I love guitars. I love the guitar community and all of us do at the company. And we are just really excited and stoked that the community has embraced Kramer and Gibson and what all we're doing with the brand and how we're trying to bring it back, so to speak. So
yeah, well, I love to hear that passion, and that really rings home, because there's some people out there, building guitars for some people is a job and strictly a job. It's not really a passion. It pays the bills, and nothing wrong with that. And some people that are out there building, don't even actually play. It's their job, and they do their job very, very well. But it's really cool when you see someone like yourself and some of the people that I've had over on the other show on the Helix Hour as well, too, when the passion is so much there that, kind of going to work is not necessarily work. Sure, you're getting a paycheck, but it's not really work.
Yeah, the brand, the love of the guitar and the love of the brand is something that all of us at the company have, and especially our team of product specialists. And we go to stores every day and we share our passion and love for gear. And it just so happens that we work for a company that we have wanted to work for a long time. And for me, my very first electric guitar was a Kramer Aerostar.
Yeah.
And my parents bought that for me. I was 12 years old. My mom was telling my brother and I, hey, look, wouldn't it be cool if you started playing an instrument? I come from a Filipino Chinese heritage. Mm-hmm. So back in Seattle, where I grew up, it was all about Suzuki Method and playing piano and all that. But we moved to Nashville back in the 80s and MTV had just started up. And the love for guitar was really set then.
Mm-hmm.
And Van Halen, especially during that time, I remember going to my friend's house when I was a kid, and this is maybe 1980. Oh gosh, maybe it was right around 1984. Right. So anyway, I was a few years old, and he brought me 1984 to listen to from his brother's record collection, and just blew me away. And I didn't realize that guitar could be played like that at all, right? It was such an eye-opening, ear-opening moment. And from there, it just got worse and worse. I got the bug real bad, and then I fell in love with Dweezil Zappa.
Nice.
And his cover of My Guitar Wants to Kill Your Mama from his father. And Cheap Trick, of course, with all the awesome guitar collection Rick Nielsen always played. And it just skyrocketed from there. It was just like nonstop. I wanted to play. Now, I wasn't ever as fast as any of those guys, mm-hmm. but I appreciated the tone. And I ended up writing a lot of music when I was a kid growing up. I got awarded as a junior songwriter at the Country Music Hall of Fame when I was 12 and played there at the Hall of Fame, which was awesome.
Wow.
Vince Gill wasn't even a known person at the time, and he gave me the award for junior songwriter, which was great. And then I learned was in marching band, and from there just ballooned into wanting to be a band director. And from there, I ended up working jobs in retail and touring with my band,
mm-hmm.
which was great, playing guitar. And it just so happened I also got a job in commercial radio. So from commercial radio and touring in the band and my sales chops, I ended up getting a call from Gibson 13 years ago saying, hey, it's awesome, that yeah, I was a Gibson artist too at the time as an independent artist, which was great.
Isn't
they really
that
believed
cool?
in me.
That's yeah. wicked.
Yeah, and I'll talk about that later, but it was just really nice to get the nod and say, we're starting this new group called the Dealer Product Specialists. Mm-hmm. We'd like for you to become part of the team. And I got my dream job, and I've been there ever since. And it's an honor to represent the company for all those years and to talk to trade show people and different media outlets. And it's been a real joy for me. Because it is. If I told my 12-year-old self that you'd be working for Kramer and Gibson and Epiphone one day or Steinberger, I'd be like, you got to be kidding me.
That's right.
You know, and then it comes true. So to those people listening and watching out there, all I have to say is it's great, as Eric had said, that when you can work a job, it doesn't feel like work. And granted, there is parts of the job that are tedious.
Yep.
But the passion that our team shares with, you know, a fellow guitar players, because we're all gearheads, we love gear, is just the best feeling in the world. It really is. And you used to work in a music store. I'm in music stores all the time. Mm-hmm. And it's fun to talk about gear. You know, everybody has their favorite pieces of gear. Everybody has their desert island guitar and effects and pedals and amps and stuff. But man, to talk about a brand like Gibson or to talk about a brand like Kramer every day is super cool. So thank you so much for having me on.
Well, you know, it's really cool. And I want to see that guitar in a second as well, too. But we were talking about this off the air the other day when we were doing a kind of a catch up. The fact that it's got to be so surreal. Like, you started off as you gave us a really great backstory on yourself. First of all, you got bit by that bug really hard for the music bug, and that's awesome. You've done really well with that. But the fact that you started off with a Kramer guitar, and now all these years later, like you say, you're here, you're doing it, you're loving it, you're putting the guitars in other people's hands, like the young yous now. You know, that's pretty cool. Full circle.
Yeah, it sure is, man. And like I said, I was in a band. We were trying to make it. We opened up for a lot of different folks, and Gibson discovered us, and it was super cool. I mean, the story goes like this, and I'll make it short, okay? Because what had happened is my band was playing, and we started doing a lot of really cool tours. We started doing USO tours, opening up and touring around the United States and abroad, and our gear got stolen.
Okay.
So all of our gear got stolen right before we were going to the studio to record. My parents didn't have a whole lot of money. This was all gear that my brother and I had. He played bass. I played guitar. And we basically snuck in a NAM.
Oh, geez.
Yeah. So Photoshop 1 had come out. We took a badge from a friend.
Oh, no.
And we Photoshopped our badges, got our press kits happening. And when all of our gear got stolen, I said, never again. Never again will this happen. And I had all kinds of guitars stolen. Luckily for me, you know, none of my Gibsons or my Wolfgang got stolen. Nothing got stolen or anything. Mm-hmm. But nothing like that. But all the other stuff did, you know. And in fact, I didn't even have the Wolfgang at the time to even record anything with. I didn't have my Flying V to record anything with at the time. So needless to say, we got in, and Epiphone and Gibson were the first people that we went to go see, and they loved it. They loved the fact that we were doing these USO tours with the likes of like Three Doors Down and Joan Jett and Drew Carey and stuff. And they were all about it. And we went over there representing Gibson there pre and post 9/11, mm-hmm. which was amazing. And we played Gibson and Epiphone and Kramer, and it was just a joy. And then when all this stuff happened, when they opened up the new section of the company, the new department, I just jumped at the chance to do it because, certainly, you know, I just love to talk about gear, and I love the brand. So
yeah,
it's really cool.
I could see why they'd want to get behind something like that as well, too. I mean, number one, and entertaining the troops, that's a good thing. And a lot of, military people are musicians as well, too. It's a win-win for everybody. You're kind of teasing them with the Gibson guitars and the Kramers and stuff like that as well, too. It's kind of an advertising thing at the same time. So it's a win-win for everybody to support that.
Oh, yeah, yeah. And they're a great company to support, not just, you know, USO and bands that are performing, anything, or whatever the case is, but also just independent musicians or musicians that are on their way up. And a lot of people you know, look at it and go, well, what can I do to get an endorsement? Well, the first thing I asked them, not that I'm in artist relations, I used to be in artist relations for another company, but mm-hmm. I would always ask him, so what do you play? You know, do you play a Kramer?
Yeah.
Maybe that would be the first step.
That's
Have you ever played
step
a Kramer?
One.
Maybe. Do you own a Kramer? You know, maybe.
Yeah.
You know, and I feel that, you know, because I had invested in the company for all that time, it was just really great that they have invested in me. And now I'm trying to give back and making sure that other people have opportunities and letting them know that the people at our company are very, you know, very artist friendly and people, you know, we tend to listen. So I just hope that those people understand that we are a very artist and very consumer centric company. So
yeah, that's something we're going to focus on in a couple of questions later here. We're going to talk about how the companies together are very artist focused, especially even Kramer back in the day when we're going to go back a little bit in time and we're going to catch up to today. But it's very important. You know, artists are a very important thing because artists are kind of the influencers, the ambassadors, so to speak. And that's something I've always talked to people, you know, when it comes to endorsements as well, too. You kind of have to be that ambassador. You know, it's not what the company can do for you. It's what you can do for the company. And you really need to get out there and not sit there, okay, can I have the silver platter? It's like, okay, yes, you as you said, do you have a Kramer? Yes, okay, so playing a Kramer, I'm out there rocking it, you know, he or she, whatever. I'm selling them direct, you know, indirectly or directly at shows, you know, that kind of stuff. So it's nice to see you now taking, you know, what you've had before and giving it back to the consumers. And that's and the young bands coming up. And there's so many great bands out there. I mean, that's one thing I don't think we're ever going to run out of is new recycled, you know, youth coming back up into the forefront. And there's some shredders out there, as you see all the time. Some of these kids can outplay us 7 ways from Sunday, so it's cool. And you know what, we're going to get into, obviously, really really deep into the Kramer, but it's amazing. It says you pick up a Kramer and you just want to go crazy with it. You don't usually pick up a Kramer and do too many jazz progressions or, you know, Chet Atkins stuff, right?
Well, you could if you wanted to,
sure could,
you know, you could. But you know, the fact is that it does harken back to that time of just gunslinger, awesome, you know, guitar playing. And that's what we all fell in love with. It represents that era very well. And I think it's coming back in a big way.
Yeah.
The retro movement is cool. You know, people like yourself and others that are taking to the internet and shredding and showing off great tones and things that you can do with a guitar that frankly have been lost.
Yeah.
Over time, you know, and people are discovering it via YouTube, and it's great. You know, I love to see John Mayer shred.
Yep.
You know, it's great that he's doing that. It's great to see that there are other younger bands out there performing. I mean, like our own artist, like Charlie Parra, you know, one of the internet godfathers of YouTube shredders, is out there every single day. And now he's performing with orchestras. He is just amazing, an amazing artist. So it's great to see that coming back.
Yeah. I've had people tell me, you know, some people say, dude, you're stuck in the 80s, you know, because I'm all and that's, you know, with obviously the Kramer, the Eddie Van Halen style guitars all the time. And, you know, honestly, if I was to be stuck in any piece, like let's say I'm in a DeLorean time machine and I don't have my autopilot set where I'm going and I land in the 80s and I'm going to be stuck there the rest of my life, I can live with that.
What's wrong with that?
There's nothing wrong with
it. I say you're stuck in the 80s. It's like, what's wrong with that?
There's nothing. I love it. Thank you for the compliment.
Where are you? Yeah, exactly. Where are you stuck at the 2018s, you know, where it's just a bunch of electronic music? Nothing wrong with that. I listen to Zed.
Sure.
It's great.
Yep.
You know, I listen to all that stuff. But I have an affinity for Dokken. I have an affinity for Rat. I have an affinity for Van Halen, and that's what I listen to. And it's just, it's great. You know, I love the fact that they're back and they're still recording, and albeit, you know, a lot of those other bands may not be as, they're not out there like with MTV, you know, doing a bunch of videos where everybody just was glued to Friday night videos or MTV, you know, watching videos and watching what kind of gear they were playing. It's not as to the forefront as it once was, but it's still there.
That's right.
And yeah, and it's funny. I mean, overseas, you know, Kramer is a phenomenon, and so is that metal music, that rock music. It just hasn't ever left overseas. You know, my friends at Night Ranger, they're still as relevant in Japan as they ever were. You know, Brad Gillis is still the man.
He is incredible.
And what a great guy, too. I have to say, Big shout out to my boys in Night Ranger. Brad Gillis is a great guy, and even we've met several times, and he is just a prince. He'll call me, talking about gear and about bringing out his old Les Paul and stuff like that, and he is just an amazing player. But all of them are everybody in the band is great.
I had a very weird, surreal moment with Brad Gillis. That was at Winter NAMM 2017. And so watching this band that was playing in one of the lounges, you know, I'm not sure which wherever it was, but one of the lounges, the Hilton or something like that. It was kind of a country, kind of eclectic country rock band. Really, really cool. Just sitting there watching them, and they had really good musicians. I look over to my left, and I kind of saw somebody I looked like. I literally right to my immediate left. And I was like, oh, my God, that's Brad Gillis from Night Ranger. Kind of, nice. You know, nodded to him. And then he took off. And then a few minutes later, I'm somewhere else, looked to my other side. Oh, there's Brad Gillis again. So I gave him my business card and everything. I said hi to him, but it was very weird. Just kind of one of those things where I look left and he's there, and I look right, he's there. And, you know, obviously being I'd never met him before and been a fan of the band over the years as a kid growing up. You know, it was a very cool moment. Just a nod. It was really cool.
He is. I have been lucky enough in radio and at this job to meet so many great musicians, and Brad is one of them. He is, once again, he's just a prince. It's like Dave Amato from REO Speedwagon. Both of them are great. I mean, I could go down the list of artists who I think were super cool. Dave Grohl.
Yeah.
You know, I have never met Eddie.
No, I was going to ask you that if you had
Eddie one day, but I would love to at some point. I would love to, but Rick Nielsen is great. The guy, everybody from Tesla has been killer. Peter Frampton, man, the list goes on. And they just couldn't have, They couldn't have been nicer.
That's wicked.
To everybody there. They're just wonderful people.
That's why you really, you know, when you're meeting your heroes, and in this case, some of your artists are your heroes too, you know, because, you know, that's kind of the bucket list for you, meeting some of these people. But even though you work with them indirectly, it's very, very cool. But it's nice when you meet them and they're genuine and they don't burst that bubble for you. Like, you know, because some people can be jerks, or you could catch them on a bad day, and we're all human. But that's nice. I want to jump over to the chat for a quick sec because I was just told we have some questions coming up. So we'll say hi to a bunch of people, and we'll come back to some more questions as well, too.
Sounds like a plan.
Yeah, so everybody, we're having a great chat tonight. This is real. Thank you for making the inaugural episode a really fun one. I was looking forward to this going well. Lau Ketchum is here. Jim Dales is here. Phoenix Vanderweiden is here. And Phoenix is a new Kramer artist as well.
Yay, Phoenix is awesome. She just released a brand new album, and I think our Kramers are all over it. And I can't wait to get some publicity photos from her. That'd be awesome.
Now, did I pronounce her? I'm really bad with names. Vanderweiden, is that correct?
I think it's Vanderweiden.
Vanderweiden,
I think the W would be the V.
Right, Vanderweiden. Okay, so apologies for the pronunciation, but I'm going to have to run the show.
I could be wrong.
I bet
she'll correct us. She'll be the first to correct us.
Yeah, Phoenix, let us know if we're saying that right. But I plan on having her on the show soon as well, too. Mississippi Treasure Hunter is here. Mike Francis is here. Let me see here. Phoenix is saying she thinks the show is going to be great. The Law, Jamie Trevino, speaking of Kramer artists, we got a whole artist list in the chat. This is great.
We have a lot of artists, a bunch That's of Kramer right. artists. I love it.
And I got to say this too. Jamie picked up, we're going to introduce some new merchandise here tonight. And I promised Jamie a sneak peek of the merchandise. He already bought a Kramer Korner t-shirt. We're going to show you some Kramer Korner t-shirts here tonight.
Nice. I want a Kramer Korner t-shirt.
I'll get you one.
I got to send you some Kramer t-shirts.
That'd be good. I don't have any Kramer t-shirts, actually. Not a single one.
Mine must have been in the laundry. I was looking around for it. I was like, where's my Kramer shirt, man? Dadgummit.
I have 65 Van Halen shirts, but I don't have a Kramer shirt.
I need to get hooked. We were watching your chat, your video show the other night, and my wife was like, you need to call EVH to get some EVH shirts and stuff.
Exactly.
EVH shop.
Yep, yeah, call Jeff Hausman for sure. I do. Yeah, he's a great dude. He's a great dude, and he's really got a great business going on. So my beautiful nocturnal butterfly, my better half, I almost said my beautiful butter half,
butter. she's your butter half.
That's right.
The better
my
half.
Nocturnal butterfly live chat. Okay. Yep. And I am on the live chat tonight, which is good because I'm usually not. Let me see here. I know the guys, Mike Cheever is here saying what's up. Les Bellin is here. Brad is here. Brad Peddle, Ricky Mees. And I know there's some questions, and just bear with me while as I get to it here. Hang on. I'm trying to do this as quickly as I can. Darren Moore, Rock and Roll is here. Sean Cook is here. You said you work with Steinberg Guitars as well. Any chance a trans trim model be released in the future? That's a question from Brad Peddle. Is that something you can comment on, or is it something you may have to?
Yeah, I think I can comment on that. So we had a trans trim model, the ZT3 Custom, which was absolutely killer. And you just never know what the future lies for Steinberger. We just Epiphone just relaunched the new Steinberg website, so mm-hmm. I would say stay tuned.
Okay, that's good. That's optimistic. I can live with that. Sean Cook is here. Les Bell and Kramer was my first guitar, 2000 series, I believe. Sean Zimmerman here. Chad Boston. Ethan Short is here. Let me see here. Rokamp 56 says, good evening, Eric and Aljon. I still have a 1985 Kramer Focus 1000 with Seymour Duncan D-Tuna. Very, very nice. Did I miss anybody else here? I think I did. Charles Green is here. What's going on, people? Great show. Rokamp 56 JB and Focus 1000 still sounds awesome. Miranda Becker is here. Awesome to see you two collaborate. Thank you, Miranda. I appreciate that. Mike Francis, great story with a great outcome. Okay, so that was a question from Brad on the Steinberger. Air Force from Sean Cook. Let me see here. Kramer with Maple Tops. That's from Mike Cheever. Nocturnal Butterfly has shared the Kramer Facebook page, so everyone check that page out. There's some great stuff going on there, and give it a like. It would be awesome. Scully's Woodshed is here. So this is a good question. Okay, this is a very, very good question. And it was something that was on the itinerary tonight, because there are some people, and there's nothing wrong by people not knowing this, because Kramer did close, okay, we're going to go away for a little while. And they did. They disappeared. And now they're back. He is asking, who is making Kramers now? So let's let you address that.
Okay. So Epiphone. Okay. So the Gibson brands as a company, we own Kramer and Steinberger and Epiphone. And with all that, the Epiphone brand actually handles the manufacturing of Kramer along with Steinberger. So back when Music Yo was happening, Music Yo was actually Epiphone selling Kramers direct to consumers. And during that time, I was the Gibson artist, Gibson Epiphone artist, and I did have a Music Yo Kramer, and I thought I had it here, but I must have put it in a case, but we'll have to bring it out for the next show. But it was the checkerboard 84.
Nice.
Which was killer because, as you know, I just mentioned how much of a Rick Nielsen fan I am. So I wanted to get something very Rick Nielsen-esque, and that was it. But from Music Yo, the dealers wanted to carry them in store, so we have that. But yes, Epiphone has been making Kramers. We bought the company back in the day, and here we are. We're still making them.
So there you go. They're being manufactured, and we're gonna talk a little bit about further into the program how you guys have really paid attention to how they were. Like, I mean, you put some of those actually, and I don't know this for a fact, but I was kind of given some information that some of them were almost put under a microscope to analyze them and make sure they're recreated exactly like them. So I think you've done wonders with them. And I here's another thing I want to say to you, just as a nod to, I don't own a Gibson guitar. I've always wanted to own a Les Paul, and it will be one day I will have one. I think every guitar player has to have a Gibson one day in their life. And some people like you guys and some other people here are fortunate to have many, but it's a bucket list thing I think you have to have as a musician. You need a good Telecaster, you need a good Stratocaster, you need a good Les Paul, and so on and so forth. But Epiphone is, I think the higher end Epiphone is an amazing, I mean, all of them are good, but an amazing product. Like, you guys are really doing something special with the Epiphone.
Yeah, we are. And once again, we have facilities that are overseas, mm-hmm. that have a lot of great attention to detail, that are run by Gibson employees that are there, and owning the manufacturing side stuff for Epiphone and producing it has been a real big blessing for us, because we can control that. But as it pertains to Kramer, as you said, it has been on record back when even the Vintage Kramer Forum was still active. The engineer at Epiphone, Richard Akers, has done such a great job of scanning guitars and making sure that we do make them as faithful as possible. But we also are putting players forward. In other words, you know, the volume bleed mods, using real Floyd Rose FRT 1000s, using great, you know, pots, and using, you know, sometimes the Seymour Duncan or AMG or even Gibson pickups in our models, which are great. So it's just an extraordinary value for the player. So you know when you're getting, no matter what price point of Kramer and no matter what price point of Epiphone, that you're getting a really quality instrument that has been checked and inspected. And we do have great customer service that's online 24/7.
Important.
So if something gets wonky, you know, we are happy to take care of it for the customer. And, you know, just make sure you register your guitar. I mean, mm-hmm. we're going to make sure that it's right for you, and you can order them through any Gibson dealers. We do have some dealers that do carry them, like Sam Ashes. And I got another email today. We have got another great dealer that I'm going to have to pull up on the email, but, you know, they do a really good job of, you know, selling and putting the instruments out there. And hopefully your listeners and your viewers can take it to heart and visit a store and pick one up.
Oh, exactly.
Like Long McQuaid in Canada, for heaven's sake.
Yes, I was going to mention that because that's perfect that you mentioned that, because I was going to say Long McQuaid is a great dealer. And just 2 days ago, what did we got? I guess it was Wednesday. Yeah, I think it was Wednesday. Junior and I were in London, Ontario. We went to Long McQuaid. We were down there on business. But we stopped at Long McQuaid, and they had a beautiful, and Junior just was just like, it was almost like, oh, they had the Epiphone, like I think it's the Carina V. And he wants that guitar in the worst way. And we didn't bring it down because it was way high up on, like, I didn't even want to bother the guitar salesman to bring it down because, you know, we weren't buying that day and I didn't want to waste his time. And I've been a music retail guy. I don't want to be like the Wayne's World with the, the Stratocaster and whatever, but it was beautiful. So it's a phenomenal guitar.
Yeah, absolutely. Oh, and here it is. So yeah. People are asking where they can pick up the Kramers. Just stateside, obviously Sam Ash, you can order them. You can look online to get some of that stuff. We've got Motor City Guitars. We've got Honeycutt Guitars in Johnson City, Tennessee. They're just great. Of course, Long McQuaid up north. And then we have a bunch of great dealers in Europe and in Japan that have Kramers as well. But if they have the Gibson badge, if they are Epiphone dealers, obviously they can get you the guitar that you want. And hopefully, you know, we'll have our website redone and everything like that, you know, sooner than later, and have all the new models up and some of these models too. So we'll just have to see how it goes. But it's people like you, it's people that are watching the show that love Kramer, that buy new Kramers, that we want to help find a Kramer dealer. And of course, you can always call customer service at 1-800-4-GIBSON and find a Kramer dealer near you. So
I want to talk to my local buddy here, and it's one of the music shops I frequent. There's in my area, there's three music stores, like immediate area, and I've worked for two of the three, and then one is now my favorite one I go to all the time, and he's a Gibson dealer, and mm-hmm. he carries a lot of Gibson products. Are you familiar with Frank's Music Center?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, yeah, so Steve, he's a very good friend of mine, and I haven't even said this to him yet, but I'm like, I'm going to tell him, if you can get the Kramers, because you're stocking the Gibson, and he does a lot of Epiphone volume there, I think it would be great for him to sell Kramers. I really do.
You know what? This is, if he's the Gibson, I don't deal with Canada a whole lot, mm-hmm. but if he's a Gibson dealer, have him do a clinic with you. We'll support it. You know, we'll do what we can to support it. And maybe you could do some, get some of his guitars and borrow them for demos and things. That'd be pretty sweet. We could work something out with
him. Sure, that'd be awesome. And it would be a really cool nod to that as well, because he's not an EVH dealer as far, but he's somehow obviously authorized, because he's talking Charvel and stuff like that. So he's bringing in some EVH stuff as well too. So I would have an EVH amp there and everything ready to go. And he's a Line 6 dealer, so I could have everything I need at Kramer, EVH, and Line 6 in one store. So I'll talk to him about it.
Yeah, just absolutely. Just have him email me or something.
I will, for sure. So you've been fiddling with this guitar, and I know which one it is now. At first, I thought it was pink. It's just the lighting. So what do you got there?
So this is the famed 1984 Diver Down. Mm-hmm. This is based on the 84 Beretta. And you can see here the big banana headstock. It's hard to see, and I'm sorry, my lighting here. And I don't have the big, nice lighting. I'm going to have to get some lighting like Eric does. But you can see the headstock here.
Beautiful.
You can see in the very back, we've got the tools, the skunk stripe, the quarter saw maple neck, the maple body. So it's pretty substantial. The FRT-1000, Floyd Rose. Mm-hmm. We've got the Seymour Duncan in there. We got the JB. And we have the push-pull, which is nice, so you can have that coil split action. And it just plays great. I mean, super low action. And the one thing that is different about this than the original one is you can see here there is that neck adjustment right here.
Okay.
And we actually started doing that a long time ago in the Music Yo era days before it was a thing, right? But you can take your Allen wrench and make your little adjustments there. And you can see that in the very back, you can see we do have the, you see, I still have the plastic on the back. Look at me.
Yeah.
So I still have the plastic on the back, but it is the four bolt 1984, you know, joint there. It's hard to see.
Yep,
and it
I
does have
though.
Kramer in the back, but you know, it's just super comfortable. It's what you would want for a really smooth, just a, you know, shredder style neck and very low action, very low frets. And, you know, it's just a great guitar, and we have this, and I'm sure you can pull up the website, but we've got this in that nice banana yellow. We've got it in this diver down color here, which is super nice. And we got it in a few more. I think we still have it. We haven't had it in white in a while, but yeah. So we have a few different colors and flavors that you can see on the website.
It's funny. Anytime I type in Kramer, just the word Kramer in my browser, this is funny. I'll actually have to show this on the screen sometime. It literally goes to Kramer/products, blah, 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 the 84, because that's the one I'm going to all the time. I'm not kidding.
Knows you.
Yeah. So if I, tonight, Nocturnal Butterflies asked me for links so she can share them in the chat. And I'm saying, okay, let me go grab the Kramer link. And literally, I had to take off the 84 and backslash, you know, go back to the homepage. And I'm not kidding. But that's cool. It's awesome. And I do love the fact that you can access the truss rod at the body like that, because I always find it's like, I don't want to say it's a pain, you know, with the different guitars, like, you know, like on a Gibson Les Paul or whatever, you have to take off the bell, you know, the truss rod cover, not a big deal, you know, but when you want to make a quick adjustment, that's what I love about that quick little half a torque, you're back into the game and playing. Yes. Less time messing and more time playing.
Yeah, absolutely, man. And it's once again, it's just so much fun, you know, when you get down to brass tacks. You want a guitar that feels good, that, mm-hmm. that plays great, and then also that inspires you to play, you know? So I'm just happy about all that. It inspires me to rock out every time I pick it up, so.
They're fun. I mean, they look cool. I mean, obviously, every time you look at a Kramer guitar, you go back, and we'll talk about this throughout the program as well, too, but you almost picture a few people, you know? You picture your Eddie Van Halens, you picture your Vivian Campbells, you know, there's so many synonymous names, Richie Sambora's, and on and on and on and on. I mean, you almost weren't somebody unless you were playing a Kramer guitar back in the day.
Well, this is true. When once again, it goes back to the point that you brought up, that it's so artist driven, and people like Richie Sambora, as you mentioned, Vivian Campbell, obviously, Eddie Van Halen were just great. Even Paul Dean, you know. I love Lover Boy. Everybody did back in the 80s. So, and that was great. Elliot Easton, who's a Gibson artist still to this day. Just so many great artists. Mick Mars. Hey, the list goes on and on. Everybody played Kramer.
Yeah, I love that. I love that. So you've obviously taken a lot of, you've kind of homage to the things that were popular back in the day. With a lot of us used to take, you know, pencil erasers and glue them on the back of our headstock, and I used to drill a hole and just stick my Allen wrenches in there. The fact that, you know, people want to access that truss rod, you've done things like that. It just a lot of really cool enhancements to the guitar that, you know, could be overlooked easily, but just make that a bonus for us.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, once again, we designed it with players in mind. What do players need access to the most? Well, they're Allen wrenches. If you're playing a guitar with a Floyd Rose, you better have that handy. And, you know, once again, just the fact that you can get a little bit of versatility there with the
coil push top, pull, yeah.
You know, push pull is super cool. And, you know, even though that this is set up to float, you know, there's a little bit of clearance there, but I mean, I could still put a D-tuna in there if I wanted to. And my Kramer from 1980, or the 84 Kramer that I have from Music Yo, that Music Yo era Kramer, has got a D-tuna in it. And I just wish I had it accessible, but I don't. My studio is a wreck, just so you know.
No problem.
Yeah,
that was the question I was going to ask. I was going to ask if the 84 came floating. So that answers that question. But here's something I think a lot of the Kramer, not all, but some Kramer fans may not know. And this is a good friend of ours, Adam Reaver at FU-Tone, Futone. He sells two products that will, a trem stabilizer, not the trem stopper, but he has two products available. So if you want to put a D-tuna on a floating trem, you can do it. So look up fu-tone.com, and he sells two different products, and one's, you know, a little different than the other. But if you want to do that, you want to use a D-tuna, and you don't want to have to lock your Floyd down, then you can do that.
That's a great thing about these guitars is they already have great hardware and things, and Adam does great. Like if you wanted to upgrade your Floyd block to an FU tone block or an FU tone noiseless spring or whatever that he's got, I mean, Adam's got a ton of that stuff. So hi, Adam, what's up, brother? And hopefully we'll see you soon. I missed you at Summer NAMM. I thought you were walking around. I don't remember if you came to the custom shop party or not, but we'll have to hook up sometime soon.
Oh, hell, that'll be a good meetup for sure. And and when you sent me the Pacer, the vintage Pacer, that was one of two guitars in the entire house that I have with floating trams. I'm not a floating trem guy for anything. Now, back in the day, yes, I had the Ibanez Gems. I had, you know, various different guitars that had floating tremolos, but I'm not that guy. And I thought, okay, I'm going to probably either buying a trem stopper from Adam or I'm going to flush mount it. But I also have a guitar from Line 6, the JTV89F Variax. And it's floating. And I thought, you know what? It's nice to have a couple guitars different, right? And the floating trem on the Pacer has made me play differently. And I've adapted my hand resting out my palm muting and everything already. It was a no-brainer. I learned it in seconds. And it's making me play better in different ways, too. So that's very cool. I'm glad I left it that way.
Yeah, well, it's nice to have a guitar where you can flutter.
Exactly. Right? Exactly.
You know, you can't do the Brad Gillis stuff unless you flutter it. So you got to be able to have the flutter in there and the brang and all that other stuff that you do that you can't do with a, you know, the Floyd Rose just setting, you know, setting a proper way. This is the 80-85 Beretta.
Okay, nice.
So you can see the 85. This is in blue, and it does have the stubby banana headstock.
Okay.
And the FRT 1000 as well. And this too also has the push pulls, but this one's also set to float, which is super nice. So, you know, once again, just, you know, awesome heavy ass maple.
Yeah. Was 85 USA made?
The 85 and the 84, these are all made overseas.
Okay. All right.
Now Music Yo assembled them in the United States. In this particular case, they are assembled overseas and they are set up in the United States.
Okay.
Or in your case, I believe, and they're inspected too. So as they leave, they're inspected. Our overseas plants, they're inspected. They come to us, and before they go to our dealers, they're inspected. And the same goes for our Canadian brothers. And then when it comes to the EU, we do have set up shops and stuff like that there in the EU. So there is, you know, that inspection process that goes into the guitars before they make it out the door. Now, in transit, we all know things do happen. Things tend to shift and change. When your guitar is on a boat, you know, things do change.
Climate changes.
That's why climate changes, humidity, all these other factors. So that's why we have that in place, so that we, you know, that the guitars are inspected or whatnot before it goes to a dealer. And then the dealer can, you know, as it hangs and acclimates, you know, they're supposed to maintain it a certain way as well. So we want the experience to be very good. And with a guitar like this, obviously, you know, we definitely love the fact that, you know, they're set up and maintained, and like out of the box, they just play just superbly. They play so good.
I can give a true testament to that, because I'd have to go back and watch this, but I know this for a fact because I did an unboxing, and sometimes this you can shoot yourself in the foot doing a live unboxing, and that's why I do like to do them, for the sole fact I like to live on the danger edge, because it's believable, right? So if I'm opening up something for the first time, I'm testing it, and I haven't fallen flat on my face yet. I mean, knock on wood, it's coming, but I haven't yet. And I did it with pedals, and people are like, okay, this guy is learning it with us. So if he can learn it, I can learn it. And that's my intention. So I opened up the two Kramers that one night, the Assault and the Vintage Pacer. And I thought, you know what? Actually, this feels awesome. Let's plug it in. I plugged it in. I hit an E chord, and I was intonated. It was perfect. Now we're coming from overseas to warmer climates in the USA, and up in here to cooler climates at the time in Canada. And it was perfect. Now I know that's not going to happen every single time. Like you mentioned, there's the different factors, and I know you didn't give me any special treatment than anybody else. It was perfect.
Nice. Well, that's great. Once again, a testament to the people that work at Epiphone at our distribution centers and stuff. I mean, they do such a great job with setups, and very rarely do our product specialists have to go in and do an extra setup. But of course, you know, we do on occasion.
Yep.
And it just happens. You know, guitars are made of wood.
Every piece is different.
Tends to shift, and sometimes a tree just wants to be a tree sometimes. and you just have to make sure that you do what you can in order to make sure the wood is happy when you build the guitar initially, and then afterwards just trying to maintain that. So that's just a testament to the quality of the products that we're doing, and I'm glad it worked out great for you. I remember seeing that unboxing. I'm going, well, let's see what happens.
I know,
because
it could have went south. You never know. But I will continue to do that because I like that honesty. And if it had been bad, you know, like I always find something good to say, even about something bad. So even if it might have been out of tune, I would have said it's natural, right? So, but I didn't have to do that. So that was awesome. Let's jump back over to the chat for a quick second. Here's another question from Sean Cook. And it's something you can elaborate as little or as much as you want to. He says, please explain the endorsement process. So Joe guitar player or, you know, a girl guitar player out there wants to approach you for an endorsement. What is the process that they should go through?
Well, first and foremost, I have to say that I am in sales and marketing. Mm-hmm. So I do not have... I am not part of our entertainment relations department, although they do a lot of great scouting of talent and things of that nature. But from my experience, I think it's just important, A, that you invest in the brand that you want to endorse. You know, I think that's just key.
Yep.
For one. So do you play guitar? Do you play that brand of guitar? Do you play that brand of guitar strings? And approach a company that you feel that you can you have a connection with. And not just a company that you feel like you're going to get free stuff from.
That's right.
And that is just, you know, no bueno. Mm-hmm. But I'm sure other people in our entertainment relations department would love to hear from artists. And if you just want to call 1-800-4-GIBSON and connect with artist relations in some way, we do have artist relations offices all around the world. And I think we would love to hear from you. And maybe we'd love to see you at one of our events, you know, so just be on the lookout at Gibson.com or KramerGuitars.com and figure out where we're going to be in the months to come and just come out and see us and say hello. Be prepared.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. And bring your chops.
I think it's just really important to establish a relationship, if anything. You know, I think that if you come across like, hey, you know, I'm nobody, you know, but I want to start a relationship with you and maybe you want to hook me up with some free stuff, maybe not be the best thing to do. And believe it or not, a lot of people, a lot of us, I have friends at Line 6, right?
Yeah.
I have friends at EVH. I have friends at Dunlop, right? And we all know everybody.
I know. It's a very small world. In
some
cases,
we all know everybody.
In some cases, some of you guys work for multiple companies. So, I could be talking to you at Kramer and you could also be, you could be a Dunlop guy. You know what I mean? I'm not saying that you are, but you could be, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's right.
Right, right. I mean, the thing is that people in the MI industry tend to change jerseys.
Yeah. You know? Yep.
And I've been lucky to have this jersey for 13 years. But before I had this jersey, I had another jersey on too at mm-hmm. one point. And that jersey was great. It taught me a lot of the MI business and made a lot of connections. And that's where I just continually just learn about the business that I'm in and about other players and what they want. So I think it's just really important to be humble.
Yep.
And have a good relationship with people and just be real. And I think that if you're talented and you are honest and have a great heart and are humble and are willing to do things for the company, like go out there and do clinics and mm-hmm. promote and do this, that's great. What type of value do you bring to a company? And I say that for everybody, you know, what kind of value do you bring to your company? And like I said, I am not in the role of an artist relations person for our company at this time. But I can just speak on behalf of what I know from my previous experience working in artist relations. And but like I said, it sometimes it's just a very simple thing of just getting to know someone at an event and starting a relationship like that.
And one thing I'd say, that's perfect advice. And when I got endorsed by EVH, that was back in the day of mailing a postal press kit. you know, like DVDs and a nice glossy this and all that kind of stuff. Sticking
same
in the
here,
mail.
Man.
Yeah, right? Yeah. It's a different day today. So here's my piece of advice for people. We have the internet available to us. Everyone has the internet everywhere. Everyone has a social media account for the most part, umpteen of them. Get a YouTube page, put some videos out there, do your stuff on Instagram and all that. Instagram is a good hot button. And tag some of these manufacturers, tag Kramer, tag Gibson's, tag the EVHs, tag Line 6, using that product. Show that you have it, show that you have a multiple of their products. And first of all, even if you only own one product and you're playing it and you tag them, a lot of times you and these other manufacturers are going to be, hey, this is free advertising for us, so let's reshare it. That's a start for you. That's a start of a 360 engagement between the artist and the manufacturer. So just do that with no expectations, and you never know. When you're not looking for things, sometimes they will come and seek you out. Someone might say, hey, you know, I saw your video, you got like 15,000 views in that same day post playing that Kramer guitar, like, you know, just hypothetically here. And that's what you do. Just get out there and play, have fun, smile, and who knows what could come.
Well, exactly, right? So with Kramer social media, you know, they tag Kramer and they contact Kramer on the Instagram, and the guys at Kramer are awesome about replying back to that stuff and questions, especially on Instagram, just because it's so readily accessible, right? And you can share awesome pictures of you playing live, and oftentimes the people at Kramer will retweet it because they're badass looking photos, and that's what we love. We love to see people playing the product and supporting the product, doing videos just like you did and other Kramer artists that are in the chat today. That we're so grateful for, that are passionate about the product. They love it. They want to take pictures of them playing it. They shoot videos of themselves playing it and using it every day. And for those people that are watching that are Kramer aficionados from even way back in the day, from the beginning of the company, if you ever were involved with Kramer in any way, we love that. The legend lives on. We want to be able to continue supporting you and paying homage, because we love the past, Kramer's past, but we also want to embrace new players as well that love what we're doing today and carrying that torch for the years to come. So just tag us in your post. That would be a great way to start, and letting people know that you love Kramer, that you play Kramer, and you support the brand.
That's awesome. So that was a question that originated from Sean Cook. So there you go, Sean. Hopefully that helps. And best of luck to you as well, too, if you pursue that. I wish you very great luck on that. I'm going to take a quick second here as well, too. This is something that Nocturnal Butterfly has put a lot of effort into as well, too. So people have been asking us here throughout the EVH and Gear TV channel, Helix Hour, and now here with our brand new entity of Kramer Corner. When can we get some merch? When can we get some merch? And I've had some coffee cups here, and I've had some stickers here and there, but so busy producing the shows that I just don't have time to get the stuff. And I was doing the physical, making the merchandise, going to the t-shirt shops and having them make me 2,000 and blah, blah, blah. So we've teamed up with Teespring, a lot of people using Teespring out there. So I'm going to just flip over to a screen very quickly. Then we're going to come back to some really, really cool guitar content. We're going to talk about some of the folklore about, you know, the relationship between Eddie Van Halen and Kramer back in the day. And it's never been more scrutinized. And it's almost like the lunar landing, people trying to figure out what actually happened, right? And what's Eddie doing? But I'm going to switch over to a screen real quick here. So we have a new merchandise lineup, Kramer Corner, the Helix Hour, EVH and Gear TV, and Sandra Lee has brought out her own new brand here called Broad Stash. So people obviously know, you know, me with the mustache. So you can see up in the top here as well, too, we've got the Kramer Corner shirts. We've got all kinds of Kramer Corner various incarnations. You've got EVH and Gear TV, got the Helix Hour. We've got tanks. We've got hoodies. We've got zipper hoodies. We've got stickers. What else we got? So if you want to get to that, I think Nocturnal Butterfly will throw the link in the description. There's a really cool electric green Kramer Corner shirt. I know, Aljon, you can't see this at the moment, but we've got ladies, tanks, all kinds of good stuff. Just go to broadstash.com and you can place your order now. And we're certainly not making a killing on these things. Any of the profits that we do make, which is very, very little on top of that, just goes to kind of further accent our programming here on the show. So that gives you a little bit of an idea. But I'm going to jump back here, and I know she'll post that link here as well, too. So the question I want to ask you, and that is basically, like, as I alluded to, is the, you know, Eddie Van Halen was one of the first people, I'm not saying necessarily the very first, but one of the very first people that really made, okay, what's this Kramer? What's this Kramer about? And, you know, with his 5150 guitar and other incarnations down the road, everyone has an opinion of what it was. And we're not going to get into what it is tonight, because sometimes no one even really 100% knows. But have you ever known any, and a working relationship between two people, Kramer and Eddie Van Halen in this case, that has so much folklore and mystery behind it?
Man, I do not. Eddie just has a lot of folklore behind his gear. I've got books and magazines, much like you do.
Yep.
And I collected every magazine Eddie Van Halen's been in. A lot of us at the Gibson Epiphone office have as well. Just because, you know, his nickname was the Fountain, you know?
Yeah.
So it's kind of like, that's kind of where it was, right? That kind of launched the million ships, a million of us little guitar players that wanted to play and have that brown sound. So I can tell you that we have people that work with our company that are very close to Eddie and his techs. We've got our master luthier had worked with Eddie on those projects for PV and subsequently EVH, which was great. Now he works for us, but they were very integral into the making of the guitar. And I'm sure they've asked him tons and tons of questions about the type of gear that he had and talking about the bodies, you know, the original Frankenstein, and then moving into the 5150, his Kramer that he played. So it's just, it's cool, you know, and I'm happy that Ed's doing his thing. Mm-hmm. You know, we're all happy Ed's doing his thing, but, you know, there is so much folklore to that and what he actually did and the guitars, the other Kramers that he owned that he was photographed with, like his Ripley or, mm-hmm. you know, or so the other stuff that he's played over time, you know, the Beretta, the No Bozos. I mean, you can just go, the list goes on and on, man.
I know.
You know, it was so cool. I wish, you know, Music Zoo did a run of just very limited, like Kramer 84s with the No Bozos on it. And I was just like, I want that guitar so bad. I want it.
Wouldn't that be cool?
Yeah. Well, you know, that was so limited that it went by really quick. So
I guess what you could do today, I mean, it's so easy to, you know, manufacture vinyl printing. I would just pick up a cream one and get a vinyl print, stick it on the guitar.
Well, I'll leave it with you to do that.
Okay, all right.
You can do that all you want. We're not going to touch that one, but
yeah,
you know, we had fun with it while it lasted.
So. That's awesome. A question over in the chat from Insomniac Matt. He always likes to ask string questions, and okay. He's asking, what strings does this week's guest use? And I'm quite curious, because I don't know either what you use. What do you use and gauges?
Okay, so typically I use Brightwire Gibson's 10 to 46, okay? And I happen to like Dunlop strings as well.
Yeah.
I've used, what do I have here? I've got the, I'm a big fan of ZZ Top. So I have got some of Billy F. Gibbon strings hanging out here somewhere in the studio. They're hanging out somewhere here. But the Reverend Willie strings are just, they're just great. They feel great to me. But I also love Daddario, Ernie Ball. I mean, I've played it all. I've played them all, much like yourself.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, the Gibson strings are, obviously I work for the company, so that's what I'm using. But I also am partial to the Reverend Willie Dunlop strings too. I have that on a couple of my Les Pauls, and they are killer. So.
And if they, and Billy using 8-gauge strings at times.
Okay, so he does that, and like 7.5s, and I don't do that. But I use tens. That's definitely what I use. And you know, the thing is too, you know, some guitars, a lot of players don't utilize this, but some guitars just sometimes call for a different gauge of string.
Mm-hmm.
Believe it or not, I mean, so if you feel like, you know, even though this is a 25.5-inch scale guitar, so, you know, having 9 to 42 on this feels really good. Sometimes having tens would be great. And I think it's just a matter of experimenting and what better mod can you do for an inexpensive, you know, amount of money than to experiment with different strings, different string alloys, and definitely different string gauges. And you can get different responses. Now, I remember you talking about how tracking digitally with thicker strings, larger gauge strings does help, and this is true.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Gibson had developed a string called humbucker strings, which were very great to track digitally because of the metal alloy that we used on that. But yeah, any one of those things, if you're doing a lot of like modeling, you're working with the Helix or you're working with the Headrush or whatever you're working with, getting a thicker string so that it tracks in a digital environment better is definitely the way to go if you wanted to do that.
I agree. And there were times where actually I kind of laughed when I said eights, you know, with Billy Gibbons, but there were times back in the day on Ibanez Gems and a couple of the Kramer Strikers I had as a late teen, I was using eights and I was busting in strings like left and right. And I was wondering why, obviously it's a thin string, but that was a shredder, man. And with low action and tapping, what you could do with an eight gauge set of strings was pretty cool.
Well, you know, the great thing about that and what Billy Gibbons, I've been lucky enough to meet Billy Gibbons a couple times. He's super nice, but he'd be like, son, why are you working so hard?
Yeah.
And when you have such a light touch and he does these pinch harmonics, you know, with his thumb just going back and forth, you know, raking those pinch harmonics.
Yeah.
And he didn't need to work too hard, but his vibrato was different. But if you're doing a wild vibrato like Eddie Van Halen, where you're literally doing these huge bends where you're bending even a step and a half sometimes, you know, doing the wild bends, you got to have a little bit of meat, you know, on there, just so that you can, you know, maintain that tone and it doesn't just, you know, go out, you know, you got to have a little bit of that tone there. And the fatter strings help to facilitate that. In my opinion, your mileage may vary. So yeah, you have to experiment with what works for you. You
know? I like that when you said, he says to you, you know, why are you working so hard? Right.
Yeah, absolutely.
It doesn't have to be that hard.
We have my friend that plays in a band. I play in a cover band in a funk band occasionally here in Nashville, and he set up Billy's guitar. He said that story, and Todd was like, you know, I can't believe he plays with these spiderweb strings.
I know.
The spiderweb strings he had to set up Billy's guitar, and I couldn't believe it myself. I'd heard about it, but it's different when you actually see it.
Yeah, it's like dental floss.
It's just dental floss. I can't believe it, man. But you know. You know, and it's counterintuitive to what we know from Steve Ray Vaughan. Right?
Yeah, the opposite, 13 gauge.
Like, yeah. How does he get his monster tone? Well, he plays 13s.
Yeah.
And then you listen to Billy Gibbons and he plays 7s. And you're like, really? That comes from Billy Gibbons? But man, sometimes it's all in the fingers, right?
Another example is George Pajon Jr. He's been on my show a couple times from Cairo Knife Fight, you know, and Black Eyed Peas and stuff like that. And I know he's using some crazy tunings. I don't even want to venture the number of the strings, what he's using the gauge. But I mean, basically it'd be like pulling off my brake line cable on my car and giving him that as an elevator cable. And that'd be his E string, you know, it's just like, exactly. Good Lord, you know, but it is what it is.
It is what it is, man. I love just modding the guitars and changing the guitar string, changing your pick.
Yeah. That's a huge difference.
Yep. A huge difference, you know, and if you're in the studio, like Eric has been, like I've been, sometimes you get the metal pick, sometimes you get, you know, the whatever it is. I'm using these Dunlops right now, these Tortex picks.
Those are nice. Yep.
You can see it. Oh yeah. It's got my name on it. How about that?
Look at that. Nice.
But yeah, sometimes you use those and I just like the grip on these, but you know, Les Paul, he made his own guitar pick. So it's whatever works for you that gives you the tone that you want.
I agree with that. And sometimes people really don't think that a guitar pick is going to make that much of a difference. So here's two things you can do right off the get-go that are very inexpensive. You know, forget about changing pickups and things like that. Change your style of picks. Change a gauge or a brand of strings. And you'll see what that does for you.
Yeah, the different type of string
interact
alloys
with the pick. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
You mentioned the NYXLs, right?
Yeah.
Great. Or Ernie Ball Cobalt, or you know, whatever it is you're looking for. You know, some people like coated strings. So it just really depends on, you know, how it reacts to your pH and your skin and what type of tone you're looking for. But I will warn you, when I was playing, I started playing stainless steel strings back in the day, and sometimes stainless steel is really, really rough on your frets.
Yeah.
If you're doing a lot of crazy bends and stuff like that, because you know that alloy is actually harder than your fret.
Yeah.
So you need to be very careful with that, because I didn't realize that when I was a kid, and I had to refret my guitar quite a bit. So
yeah, take that as a note for sure.
Yeah, be be very careful. Use stainless steel frets with stainless steel strings.
Yes.
How about that?
And then you might be, you're safer that way.
You might be safer, yes.
Yeah. Over in the chat, Darren Moore, Rock and Roll, says, playing my new old Kramer 404 makes me want to be Vito Brada or Eddie Van Halen. And I think he's referring to that new one that he got. It's a used one, obviously. But our good friend here, mutual friend, Jamie Trevino, he did a hot rod on that for him. And that was really, really cool. So Darren's really jumped into the Kramer family head first. And you know, he's really enjoying it. He started seeing me and Jamie playing them. And was getting that bug. And he's thrilled. And I'm really happy to see that. He's a good player.
Man, I am too. And he also brings up Vito Brada.
Yes.
Let me tell you how badass Vito Brada is. I am such a huge White Lion fan. And Michael Wagner, legendary engineer, you know, he lives here in town. I've been to his studio. It would be so cool for us to do a live show over at his Wireworld studio.
Oh, because cool.
There you can get, he's got Gibsons, he's got all kinds of great guitars, but you know, he's worked for Skid Row and Extreme and all those folks with the monster guitar tunes. And he worked with Vito, and I have to say that White Lion is one of my favorite bands. And Vito, I know you might be out there in the internet taking care of whatever you're taking care of, but man, it would be great to see you play guitar again, man.
I'd really love to have him here on the show sometime too. That would be fantastic.
And a Steinberger artist at that.
I know. Hey, here's a name you'll recognize, a good friend of mine and a good friend of a lot of ours here, and someone who's a mentor to me as well too, when it comes to YouTube. Steve from Boston's here.
All right, Steve.
Yeah, he has two comments.
I was just on his show just watching before I came on your show. But Steve, how you doing, buddy? Great to see you at Summer NAMM. And hopefully we'll get to be on your show talking about some Kramer soon, because he's a Kramer guy too.
That's right. I know. That's awesome. And Steve, I want you to come on here too. It's been a while. I had you back when you had your other identity, but I want you to come back. We'll talk some more some stuff as well too. But he says, you had me at Dokken. And he also makes a further comment too, saying Brad Gillis' performance on Ozzy's live album from 82 is just amazing. That was insane. That was like a raise the bar for rock guitar. It was just
my
insane.
God. And if you see the Japanese tour, was it the Japanese tour on YouTube? He did. There's a bunch of footage, and some of the Japanese tours are just captured so perfectly on VHS and transferred to YouTube. I mean, it's just amazing stuff. I mean, whether it be the Ozzy stuff or the Night Ranger stuff, or just so many, like the Kiss, when Kiss went over to Japan, they have great bootlegs that are on YouTube. You need to go see that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Seek it out.
Mike Francis says, I want a Kramer, just don't know what to get. Hit the website up and just shop around. Just spend some time on there. But I'd recommend something with two humbuckers. You know, it gives you the best of both worlds. No pun intended. And it certainly wasn't a Van Halen reference. But, you know, coil taps. I mean, the guitars are so versatile. A two humbucker guitar with dual coil taps. There's so many things. I would recommend. I particularly like what I have. I'm going to pull it up. There you go. I like that.
Yeah.
I'm going to pull mine up real quick.
Yeah, go for it. So what Eric is reaching for right now would be the Pacer Vintage. And there you go.
Yeah.
So he's got the candy, what was it, metallic red?
Yeah.
Which is awesome. I have here, and it's hard to see because I have a purple, I have a kind of a purple a studio here, but this is the glitter green.
Oh, nice.
Right? It's the glitter green. And then I also have the purple one here too. And once again, you know, you got the Duncan JB, JN. You have here the coil splits, which are super cool. And then the FRT 1000, man, you know, maple neck and just, you know, still heavy, you know, maple body. But, you know, once again, just killer. Boy, and I'm leaning on that one really hard. Yeah, I hadn't tuned up this guitar in a while, but I played this one. Last time I played this one was at Blake Shelton's club downtown Nashville before CMAs when it opened, and I was doing live band karaoke, and it was fun because, you know, you get to play all the Bon Jovi that you want that day. Garth Brooks and Bon Jovi all day long, all day and all night. So that's what you do there in Nashville, playing at those karaoke bars. So that's what you do.
That's pretty awesome. And speaking of awesome, this is cool. Jamie Trevino, The Law, says, Brad Gillis and I watched Starship together. That's a pretty cool moment. You and your one of your guitar heroes watching Starship. That was down south when he was in the Caribbean there doing the 80s in the Sand or whatever it was.
Yeah, man. And I can tell you that Starship is no joke. I love Starship. And Craig was an awesome. He was a great, great artist, you know, and what a great, I don't know if Craig's still with them, with this incarnation, but I've seen Starship a couple times at Disney. So, and they're great, great band.
Yeah.
For sure.
Phenomenal. Here's something I wanted to mention. This is something I think was one of the secrets to success for Kramer, because the Kramer guitars from day one back in the day till today were offered at a price point that I think pretty much everyone can afford, and some of them are even extremely entry level. So do you think the price point because of the guitars has a lot to do with why they're in so many people's hands?
Yeah, I think so. They're super accessible, and we have guitars that are at retail for under $400 and under $1,000. Mm-hmm. So I think it's great. You know, even if you have a licensed Floyd Rose and two humbuckers, man, it gives you the body style and the neck that you love. It gives you some really cool, you know, comfortable playing. You know, it's a comfortable playing guitar. And down the road, you want to upgrade it. You know, it's a guitar ready to be upgraded. And there you have it. And you can still use that awesome body. So those Pacers are great for that. And the Strikers are killer guitars. And once again, these guitars can be found for under $500, and they're just an amazing value. They look cool. They've got the pointy headstock like my SM1 back there in the back.
Oh yeah, that's great. Oh yeah.
Yeah, now you get to see all the guitars in the back, right? So a lot of flying V's back there, but you see that SM1. That SM1 is peeking back there, and that's really cool that you get that, you know, with the Striker, because I think people love the look and the playing, the feel, the neck. I think it's just super important with the Kramer brand. Mm-hmm. If you're shredding, you're playing guitar, you want that neck to be solid, and that's why we use that Gorson maple, you know, just to get that rock solid performance. And I think that the price just is awesome. You know, hell, you could look up, you could go online right now and look up some guitars and get them for an incredible buy right now. If you want to, just look for Kramer Pacer and you'll find some, and Kramer Striker, you'll find some incredible deals on those guitars.
That's right. And a shredder at a bargain basement price. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
There's a couple, Nocturnal Butterfly sent me a message here. She says people are requesting some jams. So were you able to set up an, and I know we don't have your interface, but do you have an amplifier?
I wasn't able to set up the amp. We had some technical difficulty with my interface when Eric and I first started, and unfortunately I haven't been able to set up the amp. We'll have to save that for next time, Eric.
All right, no problem.
The next time we'll have to play Black and Blue, or play some play some Hagar era, because you're stuck in the Roth era, so I'm gonna have to play some Hagar era stuff.
Okay, that's know? I love the same stuff earlier. Too.
You played Pound Cake earlier. I was like, yeah, that's,
you heard
that's
that. Sweet. Hey,
yeah.
I'll see if I have it hooked up here. I'll try one riff. One sec.
Yeah.
No, I'm definitely not in a position to play as far as where I would have not. I would have been sitting on my stool tonight. But let's see if I got the Helix hooked up here. And I'll give people some that intro that they heard tonight was actually written with this guitar in line 6. Helix, one second here. See what we got. See if we can hear this.
There you go.
Oh, that's bad. I think it was something like this. There you go.
Yeah,
this
guitar
rocks. That's it. Yeah. So this, you know, actually, go ahead.
I let everybody down because I was getting ready to hook up stuff to my interface, and it just didn't work out for some whatever reason. It didn't work out this time, but next time.
Guaranteed. That'll be fun. That'll be a lot of fun.
It will. We're gonna have to do live karaoke here on the Kramer Corner.
That would be fantastic.
I don't know how the latency is going to work out.
You'd never know.
It could be the biggest car wreck known to man. But
here's a good example of what we talked about earlier. You know, we talked about people, you know, just putting stuff out there on YouTube and stuff like that, just sharing their love for the product. There's a fellow in the chat I just met strictly. Actually, it was a recommended video because I've been doing so much Kramer stuff lately that Kramer recommended videos are popping up now, obviously looking at my search history. And so Hank Coffey popped up and he did an unboxing the other day on a Kramer guitar, and you could see his passion. He was loving it. He was showing off the, you know, the Kramer logos on the frets, the headstock, whatever, all that kind of stuff. And it made me subscribe to him right away. I stumbled across him and I commented on his video and I said, I found you by accident, but I'm subbing because of it. Great to see the passion. I told him about the new show. He's subscribed to me now. And it's like, it's so cool how the community has come together just with a mutual love of guitar.
Yeah, you know, and it's great that people have a place to come and share their experiences with gear, especially our Kramer brand and all the gear that you love to promote on your various channels. And I can't wait to go through all the comments and interact with people. I'll be reposting this on the Kramer Facebook, so be sure to just like Kramer Guitars USA on Facebook and Kramer Guitars US on Instagram. And tag us as well, because we'd love to see you do unboxings, play videos, you know, do a little demo here and there. And we'll definitely try to get those folks over there at Kramer to share it, because they're super about sharing that type of content. So
it's very cool. I did forget to post your Instagram link, and I feel very bad I didn't do that. But in the chat tonight, we do have the Facebook and the website. So Nocturna will share. I'm sure she'll grab the Instagram link and share it before the program is over in the chat. But that's really cool too. Instagram is great for that, because you just get to flip through. You could be in the grocery checkout line just flipping through and looking at all the Kramer guitar artists and people, just consumers out there having fun with that. So very cool.
Oh yeah, absolutely. And we shared that Kramer Korner banner, that graphic, which was badass. So we shared that. And Kramer Guitars US on the old Instagramage. That's us. There are a lot of fakes out there, but we are the original. So be sure to follow us and tag us on there. Use the hashtag KramerGram or Kramer Guitars or Kramer Guitars US, and we have those bookmarked, and we'll make sure the team looks at what you got going on.
That's fantastic. Yeah. James St. Mars in the chat says, been in love with my 84 since I bought in 2014. Just got done playing it, actually. Well, very, very nice. I love that. Ethan Short says, hi, how are you? Let me see here. And what else we got in the chat here? Make sure I'm not missing. There's a few people. Greetings from Arizona. Tone Wars is here. Jared, how you doing, buddy?
All right. Tone Wars. What's up?
Let me see here. I want one Kramer Korner. That's from Mike Francis. It looks like a lot of people want some Kramers. That's awesome. Let me see here. Rick Hepner is here. Let me see what else we got here. Kramer shirts. Yep, we got some Kramer shirts. Kramer Korner shirts, but we have to get some other Kramers. Tone Wars. Okay, now this is something here. I know we're not going to talk about, we can't obviously announce product development, what's coming down the road, but is there anything you can comment on a 7-string, or is that something we'd have to leave for a later day?
You know, it's all about what the Kramer fans want. And if the Kramer fans want a 7-string, we will definitely take it in consideration. Like I said, the team is very open, and that's just not for Kramer. That's for everything under the Gibson Epiphone umbrella. If there is a need, we will investigate that need. And I know that, you know, a lot of people want to see us reissue a lot of really awesome signature guitars, and those, you just never know. Those things are all in the air right now. And we do have stuff that's cooking. I can't really elaborate on that, but suffice it to say that if you pay attention to us on social media, you just never know what's going to happen. But we do listen, and the Kramer team tries their hardest to reply to notes and emails that are sent. But I think Instagram is probably the best way to get your voice heard as to what you want and what finishes and what reissues. I know that people want left-handed guitars, and they want to bring back American-made guitar art guitars, man. All of that, you just never know. You have to we just want to supply people with the best quality products we possibly can at a great price that people will buy them. Those are always factors with any company, is making sure that your consumers are being served in the price points that they want. And that's all we can do, is just to try to give people the best product. And right now, you know, the 84, for example, is a guitar that we can't keep
in stock
off the shelf.
I know.
People buy them very quickly. We're trying our best to keep up with demand. And I'm sorry, like I said, I didn't realize I look so purple.
It's okay.
So we're going to try to change that right now. So yeah, here you go. Let's see. Is that better?
Maybe. There you go. Look at that. Look at you go.
Yeah, man. Okay, we're changing. It's still kind of, well, we're going to have to get some front light.
No problem. That's good. That's cool. That's good. That works. We've got Francisco Gurdy in here from, if I'm saying it properly, which I probably not, greetings from Costa Rica. That's pretty cool. The question I wanted to ask you is, does the current Kramer team talk to the guys in the shop from, you know, back in Neptune and things like that? Do you have, are there any conversations or, you know, emails, traded plays, or just any kind of fun, you know, banter?
Well, in terms of talking to the old guard, we have some people I think that have friended some of those people, but okay. I know that Richard in engineering and some of the other folks have been to like those Kramer expos and things of that nature, where a lot of the older Kramer fans and people that had once worked for the company had been. But I believe that some people have been in talks with some people, but I don't know that to be certain.
Okay.
But I would welcome it. You know, I mean, I'm easy to find on Facebook. So if anybody would want, you know, definitely hit me up. And I'm part of so many different forums that in regards to Kramer that, you know, sometimes I pop my head in those forums and on Facebook, those user groups on Facebook. So I would love that. I think it'd be great. And I would welcome it. You know, definitely would welcome it.
For That'd sure. be cool. Yeah, because there's some history there. Like, you read some of these stories that are out there, just amazing things, right? You know, back from the Eddie Van Halen days and all the other artists that would come through there. And, you know, sometimes they're good stories, sometimes maybe not the best of stories, and anywhere in between, but they're stories, and it's awesome to discuss.
For sure. Yeah, I mean, I've got, you know, a remarkable amount of respect for those people that used to work at the Kramer factory in Neptune, and artists like Dennis Klein, and the list goes on and on, you know, so. It's great. And over the course of time too, before I worked for Gibson and now working for Gibson, I've been lucky enough to meet a lot of those people back in the day. They may not remember who I am, but a lot of those people that started the company, I'd met, you know, whether it's the Vaccaros or anything like that. I mean, when they had their own guitar company, I met them and I thought that their guitars were amazing too, when they branched out and did their own thing. And, so yeah, we've got a lot of respect for those people for sure.
I like that. I want to ask you a question as far as taking yourself out of let's take yourself out of the employment role where you are right now. I want to ask you, as a fan, how cool is it for you as a fan, not as an employee, to see Kramer disappear for a while and now back and really, really shaking the industry? How cool is that for you?
It's super cool, because once again, the love for the brand is. It dates back to when I first started playing guitar, when I first fell in love with the guitar. And so watching Eddie play, you know, Hot for Teacher, you know, with that 5150 and that Kramer headstock, I'm like, man, this has got to be the coolest guitar on the face of the earth. You have the coolest guy on the face of the earth playing that guitar. Why the hell would I not want to play that guitar? And have others, you know, Richie Sambors and the Mick Marses of the world, the Vivian Campbells, for heaven's sake, Vivian Campbell, man, you know, another great guy, by the way, I have to say, super, super, super nice guy. And to see all of them playing, it was great and inspires me as a child, inspires me today to this day. I love that I'm associated with a brand. I'm proud as a product specialist for Gibson to go out there and promote it, have been given the opportunity. Thank you to the office for giving me the opportunity to be on the show tonight, because the Kramer fans are loyal. Kramer fans love the brand. Kramer fans love the guitar, and we love them just as much as they love us. And we want to be able to show that and give back to them and offer awesome products and be able to have this great community of people. And I haven't seen a community that has been made up of former employees of a brand and fans of the brand over so long, other than Gibson, you know, and Epiphone. But, you know, to be part of that legacy with Kramer is just super great. And I'm very, very proud, and it makes me happy. It really does. It, you know, anytime people bring up Kramer, whether, you know, it's your show or someone else's show, and they talk about Kramer and, you know, how they don't know if they make guitars anymore, I want to just jump out and sometimes I'll reply and say, hey, we're still alive.
That's right.
You know, we're still doing it. And it's great to be part of it in some little way. You know, 13 years is may not be a long time to some people, but it's been a great a great run, and I love that it's continuing, you know.
That is so. A good run, 13 years. But, you know, it's like going into a retail store. You drive down to a block that you never go to, maybe out of your way sometime, and you see this shop. You go in there like, oh, are you guys new here? I have never seen you before. And they're like, no, I've been here for 15 years. We've been here for 25 years. We're a second generation, you know.
Yeah. Well, and that's what it is. I think people are rediscovering Kramer because of the internet.
Yeah.
And I thought that people would love the fact that Kramer came back with Guitar Hero.
Mm-hmm.
I thought that was super cool. That, you know, out of all the video game controllers in the world, it had to be a Kramer guitar controller. You know, can you believe that?
I know.
And if I had the money back, I mean, now the Kramer guitar controllers for Guitar Hero, like, no one plays Guitar Hero anymore, but I would love that to have the old Kramer Guitar Hero controller, because I have the SG one, but I never got the Kramer one. I'm thinking, oh, it'll be fine. I'll go get it whenever. And then, of course, you know, no more. But, you know, but to have Kramers in a video game back in the day was super neat. And that kind of helped really give us another life back in the early days of that video game. And now that it's coming back with the internet and passionate people like yourself and the people that are involved watching this and seeing it in the chat is really nice. So it's awesome.
It is. It's a very warm feeling, and it's nice to be connected with all these people, guys and girls worldwide. It's very, very cool. That's why I was really excited about it.
How eclectic are our fans and our players and our artists? How eclectic are they? We have male, female, all different races, and
kids to adults, it just brings people
together, isn't it?
Yeah, it's very cool.
It's the best.
It is, and we all have our stories and memories and just, you know, warm, fuzzy feelings.
Mm-hmm. And that's really what it's all about. And I love that the show is here as a way to bring all the fans together that love Kramer guitars, that want to talk about gear and upcoming stuff and about their guitars. I think it's super cool. And I, you know what I would love? I would love to see in the comments where everybody's from and then what Kramer guitar you have and what Kramer guitar you want us to build. That's what I want to see.
That's perfect. Thank you for saying that, because guys and girls, do that, please, because these comments stay on the video. So later on, Aljon can go back and look at these and you know, make some notes. So that'd be really, really cool. So please do that. And one, and also it lets us know, just both of us as well too, that, you know, what our friends and fans are using, and we can, you know, share some stories with you as well too. So that's a great thing. Tell us what you're playing, what you'd like to see. I saw a comment earlier about a translucent finish. And I'm starting to get some notes here as well, too, that our internet connection is going weak. Now, hopefully we don't lose it. How about
Hollow Flash?
Yes.
How about Hollow Flash? Hey, man, I am a big fan of Kramer Hollow Flash finishes. I didn't get an opportunity to get a Hollow Flash when I did, especially the Stage Masters. And I would love to bring back Hollow Flash in a big way.
That would be awesome.
That's one of my personal things that I have for the company. Is like, please, guys, can you bring back Hollow Flash? Can we do it? Because I would love it.
Oh, that would be beautiful.
My gosh, man. A Hollow Flash 84, it would be like my holy grail. It would be so awesome.
That would be a beautiful guitar. I'd love to see it. Oh,
me too.
Well, what my plans are here for the future here, obviously I'll be reaching out to you and talking to you about some of your artists. I want to extend some invitations to some of them to come on the show. And I feel really good about how the first show went. This is something I'm going to continue on throughout. I'm going to be moving it from Friday nights. It won't be a Friday night because I have to continue my regular EVH and Gear TV show on Friday. But I have a couple ideas where I'm going to move it to. But I'm really looking forward to continuing this going, because I've seen a lot of fun over in the chat here tonight, a lot of love as far as the brand. And I think if there's enough love for the brand, they might like the show. So I'm going to continue to keep this baby rolling.
Awesome. A lot of love. I got love. I got a lot of love for everybody out there. And so does Kramer. And so does the family at Epiphone and Gibson. So thank you so, so, so much. And it's because of you all and your support of our brands that we get to continue living the dream, as we say. And I get to go to work every day and help sell and interact with people with these great guitars every day. So
it's what a dream come true. What a dream come true.
Really? Yeah. Seriously. Seriously.
And I know not every day is gold. And those days where you come home, you're probably like, oh, I need a vacation. But that's, you need those days to appreciate the good ones as well, too.
You know, you do. And, you know, life is life. Life happens, whether you want it to happen or not. And all you can do is just prepare yourself, be the very best person you can be that day, and just wake up and say, you know what, today's a new day. Today I'm going to pick up this guitar and I'm going to rock it. And I think that everyone should have that, you know, when they wake up in the morning, get their cup of joe and say, today I'm going to pick up my Kramer and I'm going to rock it. And you will, you know, some people say crush it. I'm just going to say, let's rock it.
Exactly. Never set a goal out. Like, it's like, I always say, like playing golf, don't go out your very first time and say you're going to hit, you know, an eagle, you know, like just be lucky if you hit three over par, you know what I mean? Make a realistic goal, but you had fun golfing, didn't you? Right. Well, same thing with your guitar.
Hey, you know what? Set your goals. Set your goals. I set my goals, and I can tell you, I am so pleased with the results. And I think that, you know, you celebrate the victories where and when you can, and you just move forward. Just keep on moving forward, as Walt Disney would say.
Yeah,
keep
exactly.
On forward. Yeah.
Well, I want to thank you tonight for spending 90 minutes with us here. This was a lot of fun. I mean, you're a friend first and foremost, but this is really, really cool. I'm very honored that you brought me into the family of Kramer artists. It's something I still pinch myself every morning when I wake up. It's like, I'm just waiting for someone to say it was a dream, dude. Get over it. It's not real. And I'm going to cry, but it's, I'm very honored, and it's humbling and amazing. So thank you so much from the bottom of my heart.
Oh, well, you know what? Once again, you are a valuable person to the guitar community and definitely the Kramer fans that are out there. So thank you for what you do, continually promoting great gear and having great guests. And I look forward to checking out the rest of Kramer Korner and the rest of your EVH and Gear TV shows. So thank you so much.
Awesome. Thanks, buddy. So everyone watching the chat, when it was tune in tomorrow sometime. I have an unboxing. I got this little guy sitting here. If you can show it, Aljon knows what that is. That is... I'm going to tell you what it is, but everyone's going
to
see
it. I know what it is. Yeah. I have one hopefully coming to me too.
Awesome. That is the EVH 5150 chorus pedal from Jim Dunlop. And that arrived. They sent that to me overnight by FedEx, overnight to me. And I'm giving it away. I'm just going to unbox it. I'm going to do a demo of it real quick to get on the channel. And I'm going to make a very simple contest and give that away to one lucky fan. I think it's going to be really, really awesome. So paying it forward once again. So everyone, thank you so very much for making it somewhat easy on me, for going easy on me, I should say, for my first attempt here on Kramer Korner. You'd think after doing a third show that I wouldn't be, you know, worried about things, how they're going. But I think it's just like a performance with a band. You know, if you don't have a few butterflies in your stomach, then, you know, I think you don't appreciate things as much. So I had a few butterflies doing this tonight, and I think it was a lot of fun, especially interacting with all you guys and girls in the chat. So watch. The best way to find out when we're going to be going our next show and what nights we'll be doing is facebook.com/EVHGearTV, and I will post everything on there. We'll have a Kramer Korner page here soon as well, too. But Aljon, anything that you want to say as we wrap up, just, you know, for like your band-wise or anything like that, or just anything else you want to promote, maybe your podcast or anything like that?
Well, you know, and thank you for bringing that up. Mm-hmm. You know, I think the best thing that people can do is just follow Kramer Guitars USA on Facebook and Kramer Guitars US on Instagram.
Right.
And plain and simple, I mean, if you want to find me, you can find me. I'm not that hard to find. But definitely, please follow us on Instagram and Facebook. I know that Eric will put the links in the show notes. And I would love for you just to be part of the Kramer community. And definitely tune in every week for this show. But we'd love to hear from you and tag us with Kramer Guitars on Instagram with your videos and your posts and your awesome photos. We'd love to see it and maybe retweet it. We'll see.
That's perfect. Well, listen, this has been a pleasure. This is absolutely awesome. I'm going to say goodbye to you off the air in a moment. Everyone, we wish you a very safe and fun weekend. And whatever you're doing out there, be safe, have fun. And we hope we're a good warm-up band, like I try to do with the EVH show as well, too. All we want to do is warm up your weekend, and hopefully we did that. And if you're at a local dealer, if you haven't got a Kramer in your possession right now, or you don't have a Kramer in your corner, go head up. There you go. See what I did there?
Yeah. I like it.
Yeah. If you don't have a Kramer in your corner, and that's what we want to do. That's going to be a new hashtag. What's in your corner? And with a K. Now, we want to see what you're tagging. When you tag Kramer, tag hashtag Kramer Corner as well too, so we can monitor that as well. I want to see what's in your corner. But hit up a local shop wherever your Gibson, Epiphone, Kramers are available. Play one, have some fun, make a deal on one with the retailer, and I think you're going to be very happy with that guitar.
Mm-hmm.
Awesome.
Absolutely. Right on, brother.
Everyone, have a killer weekend. We will see you next time on Kramer Korner. Thanks so much for episode number one. Cheers.